He was raised at the Jedi Temple on Coruscant. Many masters trained him over the years.
I've seen him do things I can't explain.
The Force is what gives him his powers. I've only known one other being like this. A wise Jedi Master named Yoda.
A visitor we have.
Goodbye, old friend. May the Force be with you.
Then his memory becomes dark.
Do you remember back home? Would you like to remember?
Holy smoke, wow, just wow, I mean wow. Episode 6, guys, is entitled From the Desert Comes a Stranger, and that wasn't the best part either. This direction takes an approach that George Lucas envisioned many decades ago when he first talked about a Star Wars TV series, looking into the world of bounty hunters, the Jedi Academy. But before we all talk about that, let's talk about the episode itself, the writing, the actual aesthetics. The quality visuals on display here is like nothing we've ever seen before. I mean, it is jaw-dropping, from the quality of the droids, the mechanics, the way Grogu moves, the lightsaber styles, everything. I'm going to talk about it all. Fixing the camera on incidental parts of the last season of The Mandalorian when Luke showed up, that was what was striking for me. The difference in the quality of the CGI. I could not stop looking at the screen. I've watched it 3 times now. And with every time, I'm wide-eyed, looking for the cracks, looking for the faults, looking for where the CGI has come from. And bro, let's get into it, man. So remember Grand Moff Tarkin and Princess Leia in Rogue One? Remember when you was amazed at the attempt of the CGI, but you just didn't quite feel it was next level? Remember when you saw Will Smith in Gemini Man looking 30 years younger and thought, my word, that looks amazing? And you saw Samuel L. Jackson in Captain Marvel 30 years younger and you were impressed? Well, this beats all of that. The level of CGI on offer here is just groundbreaking. They took what they did with Luke Skywalker showing up at the end of last season's Mandalorian and dialed it up to 11. Now the skies are the limit. Hollywood has just broken new ground. Now people who are aged or people who have even passed away will be able to come back like never before. This opens up a whole new book that Hollywood has never really had before. I don't think you guys understand the significance of this episode. There'll be some new rules and contracts drawn up for sure, because royalties will have to be paid to families for people who have passed away. Before they shot Black Panther 2, the idea was to recreate Chadwick Boseman's with technology like this, but the fans didn't like it from what they've seen before, and they chose to make M'Baku the new Black Panther. But if fans had seen this, than it would have been on. Mark Hamill once again lends his voice, although for me it also sounds like it's been digitally manipulated to sound like a younger Luke. I don't think people actually appreciate that that has happened in this episode. We even got samples of John Williams' original theme music when Luke was on the screen, topped with Grogu's theme, which brought tears to our eyes at the end of last season's Mandalorian Season 2. The music complemented the visuals in ways that nothing on Disney Plus has ever done before, or anything at this level. This was the Jedi Academy that George Lucas dreamed of. Luke's Jedi Academy, in the non-canon Legends continuity, was on Yavin 4, the same ancient temple used in the rebel base in A New Hope, and similarly surrounded by green, lushy trees and life and all that stuff. But new rules have been written here. The planet where Luke's academy is located is still unnamed in Disney's new canon. The way Luke was training Grogu parallels to The Empire Strikes Back in scenes with Luke carrying Grogu in the same way he once carried Master Yoda. And also the same somersaults and lightsaber styles, plus teaching similar balance and meditation skill, all was on show here. Seeing Grogu watching Luke's training him in the lightsaber styles, Shen Den Zhou, which was the same style Vader uses, as well as some form of Shoreshu, which is Obi-Wan style. We've seen him practicing a form of Shai Cho, which every Jedi learns as a basic art. I couldn't just believe what I was watching. Many of you guys who only watch the movies don't know anything about the styles, but playing the games and all of that stuff, it was on show here. If you don't watch the TV shows, read the books or the comics, or have ever played the KOTAR video games, then the Star Wars lore here has increased tenfold. And it's all because of not just Jon Favreau, but mainly because of Dave Filoni. This is how the universe is, guys. We are seeing Clone Wars rebels on display like we've never dreamed of. Cast your mind back to Star Wars Episode 3, the destruction of the Jedi Temple on Coruscant during Order 66. This was a traumatic memory for Grogu. This is the reason why he buried it. He's been taught a lot of things previously, and that Luke was doing some more kind of muscle memory skills, trying to reactivate old skills while learning some new ones. These events is the reason why Grogu cut himself away from the Force, from the events of The Mandalorian. I feel for Luke. He always questioned himself as a Master Jedi, always asking whether he was doing the right thing, and that plagued him as an adult. Seeing Grogu train and his mind being somewhere else made Luke kind of give Grogu a choice at a crossroad. A choice between a Mandalorian armor and the weapon of Master Yoda, which Luke himself recovered. And I'll explain that. If you don't read the comics, it's revealed in the Marvel's Age of Rebellion story, The Trial of Dagobah, that Yoda built himself a new lightsaber while he was in exile on Dagobah, after he lost his original one in the fight with Palpatine. This is the second saber that Luke finds among Yoda's things after Yoda passes away. It's on Dagobah, and he had all these things around him which he used to smack Luke's hand to say, don't touch, don't touch. When he passed away, Luke went through all of his things and found the lightsaber there that he had recreated. Anakin also had to choose whether to help Mace Windu or Supreme Counselor Palpatine in Revenge of the Sith. Luke had to choose whether to strike down his father in hatred or also sparing him. And Ben Solo had to also choose between Snoke's teachings and redeeming the killings of his father Han Solo. Not to mention, Rey also chose between her dark heritage, despite learning she was the granddaughter of Sheev Palpatine. She chooses to call herself Skywalker. And it was her choice. So you can see all of these choices have been a story throughout Star Wars lore which George Lucas had created. This was a major part of the hero's journey, inspired by George Lucas himself. Din Djarin was already calling Grogu a Mandalorian, a foundling, which is why Ahsoka asked him if Grogu actually isn't a Padawan. Did anyone find Grogu's dodging practice blast fire unreal or unnatural? It's strange. George Lucas always talked about Yoda's movements as something they never really cracked in the films. And you can see that here. There's an awkwardness to his movements because their legs aren't that long, but I love when Luke picked him up with the Force on every bounce, just like a baby walker. We never kind of saw this problem in The Mandalorian because Din Djarin always had the floater with him carrying the child. Professor Xavier style from the X-Men. I guess that's part of the cuteness of how he moves. Well, remember when Moff Gideon tries to shoot him, that wouldn't work now because he can dodge fire pretty good. Plus, he's going to be wearing Beskar armor that blocks incoming fire. I think Luke meant to push him this far because he wanted to see what was blocking Grogu. And the choice Luke gives him is a cheap way of not facing what his father Anakin had to go through as a Jedi. Anakin was undisciplined, full of emotion, which leads to a path to the dark side. Ben Solo went the same way in the future. And Luke almost feels that Grogu is carrying too much of this weight of love and passion, missing Din Djarin. Also too much pain in Grogu's vision of what happened to him with Order 66. Luke's choice with all these things was best to set Grogu free and free them both of their burdens. It was nice that the two legendary Jedi was talking to one another and how Ahsoka finds that Luke is too much like his father. She must have told him many tales about Anakin Skywalker's adventures way back in the Clone Wars. But in Act 3, just when you think they couldn't give you any more sweets, any more candies to the fans, Cobb Vanth, the Tatooine Marshal who first appeared in live-action Season 2 premiere The Mandalorian, who took Boba Fett's armour, he took out a few of the pikes and threw some spice away that had more value than Mos Eisley itself. And the skull that the Jawa Sandcrawler was carrying belonged to the Krat Dragon, the same massive creature we see in Season 2 of The Mandalorian. But in the midst of all of this, we see a bounty hunter with that Lee Van Cleef style hat and the emotions going through fans realizing it was Cad Bane. Bane, this was shock and awe from the fans. I couldn't believe it. He's considered the best and one of the most experienced bounty hunters during the Clone Wars due to the death of Jango Fett. When Jango Fett died, Bane became the de facto bounty hunter in the galaxy. Yes, for all those who didn't know, it was Bane who put a dent in Boba Fett's famous helmet, which has been seen throughout Star Wars movies, but that was never explained. So you can see there here in this clip, that's actually what happened. And this clip was actually unedited and unfinished. It was an episode in Clone Wars that was supposed to happen, but didn't make the cut. He even had a temporary alliance with Darth Maul. You saw the footage at the beginning of this video. He specialized in fighting Jedi and dueling with some of the most skilled Jedi around the Clone Wars, including Obi-Wan Kenobi and Anakin Skywalker. His reputation led to him repeatedly being hired by Palpatine, working for numerous projects including infiltrating the Jedi Temple, stealing the Kyber memory crystals containing lists of Force-sensitive children throughout the galaxy. Again, this was showed in the TV series of Clone Wars. It's possible that this is how Moff Gideon was able to get information on Grogu in the first place. Bane was later hired by Jabba the Hutt to free Jabba's uncle too. Last year, a Star Wars series called Bad Batch, which I keep telling you guys to watch, we saw Bane hired by the Kamenian president, Lamu Su, to retrieve an unaltered female clone who's actually Boba Fett's sister named Omega. We won't talk about it here, but it's my belief that Omega is actually Force sensitive, although it hasn't been proven yet. That's just my theory. But he was stopped doing that with the intervention of fellow hunter Fennec Shand. Bane was working for the Pike Syndicate on Tatooine, assisting the Syndicate in their expansion of the spice trade onto the planet. Now he's in play, this just got pretty serious, guys. This episode is a 9.5 out of 10. It's too strong to be a 9 and I cannot give it a 10 because it wasn't like last season's end of Mandalorian Season 2 where we saw Luke and I gave that a 10. This wasn't it. But with the show that's supposed to be centered around a criminal underworld, two of the last episodes have been about the Mandalorian and Grogu, and I'm really surprised to see so much exposition on characters from The Mandalorian and not Boba Fett. At this point, I just want it to stay like it is. However, it is all tied to Boba Fett in the war against the Pikes, and also with the Darksaber and Bo-Katan. Grogu has a kind of Matrix-styled red pill, blue pill problem to solve for next week, and Luke was in his right mind to give him that choice. You also knew that Ahsoka felt it too. In many ways, I think that's the reason why she paid them a visit, to nudge Luke into making the decision to let Grogu go. We all got that feeling from last season that Grogu just wanted to meet one of his own. He wanted to meet a Jedi. Not to go with them and spend the rest of his life without Din Djarin. And that's a price way too high for love and being a family member. That's why Ahsoka was trying to discourage Jin from seeing Grogu. She knows, as she felt the Jedi Order during the final arc of Season 5 in the Clone Wars, Ahsoka was framed and imprisoned for a deadly explosion and a subsequent murder, both of which were committed by her friend Barriss. Ahsoka became disillusioned with the Jedi Order because they didn't trust her. Now she's a grey Jedi who walks her own path, hence her lightsaber is kind of white-grey, due to her forsaking the ways of the Jedi, but still allowing a path for good. And she'll be around for some time, guys. The Tungrota's lifespan is a standard years, but for those who are keenly attuned to the Force, they could live up to 200 years. And Boba Fett is set 5 years after Return of the Jedi and 30 years before The Force Awakens. So in our current timeline, Ahsoka is 72 years old. And here's something for you deep cut Star Wars fans. Remember in the last film, A Rise of Skywalker, we actually heard her voice. But she's still alive. What's strange is all of those other Jedis who talked to Rey in that Force vision was dead. And one was with the Force. However, Dave Filoni shared a drawing that told us that Ahsoka isn't dead when she speaks to Rey. So, just wanted to cover that with you guys. But Luke wanted Grogu to leave. In 1980's Empire Strikes Back, it was Luke that wanted to leave. Both Yoda and the ghost of Obi-Wan Kenobi. They urged Luke to stay on Dagobah and complete his training. But Luke made a headstrong decision to go and help his friends, something he always believed was the risk. So he gives that choice to Grogu, not just for helping his friends, but to live his life. Luke's words were, "This is a short time for you, but it's a lifetime for someone else." Luke is basically telling Grogu to complete Din Djarin's life, as there will always be time to focus on his own, meaning you can come back and learn to be a Jedi if need be, and it wouldn't be that hard either. I'll explain why. Because Ahsoka and Luke talked about training Grogu wasn't actually training. It was more like remembering. Grogu's already been taught by many Jedi Masters, we know that. He's already told Ahsoka that. He hid those memories away and Luke knows he can support him by finding them again. Hence why Luke gives him the option to leave. Those basic Jedi skills are already within Grogu. One example I have for you guys is, there's a high level ability called Force Heal, which Grogu used Force Heal on Greef Karga's arm wound in the same way in Season 2 of Mandalorian, in the same way that Rey healed Ben Solo. So there's a strong chance Grogu sensed Mando was in danger through one of his meditations. But Luke and Ahsoka knows one aspect of his life that will be hard to overcome at this point will be his attachment to Din Djarin. It's something they always questioned. So Grogu will leave the Jedi Order to become a Mandalorian. Let me know what you guys think. I'd love to hear it in the comment section below. Now it's time to focus on the last episode for next week. Thanks guys for listening to my review, and I'll speak to you guys in the next one. Peace out.